Session is on Regional Cooperation for Food Security to be chaired by Professor Mahendra Deb, Director IGIDR Bombay. The special address will be given by Dr. Joshi, Director IPRI. Lead presentation by Dr. Posraj Pandey, President Swati. And other panelists are Abid Suleri, Mustafizur Rahman Saab, Professor Ayan Mukherjee, and Mr. Math Hamil from SCAP South Asia and Southwest Asia office. So we start at 11 o'clock and try to finish by 12:15 because we have another plenary session to go before the lunch break. We have called and maybe you can start. They will be joining. Thank you, sir.
So we'll start at 11, no? We'll start at 11.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is 10:57.
Okay.
If you start early, fine. Get 3 more minutes.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for inviting me, RIS and the UNSCAP South and Southwest Asia office. This is an important session for South Asia, the food security, regional cooperation for food security in South Asia. In fact, I have written recently, what are the costs of ignoring the hunger and, food security and malnutrition in India and South Asia. Because apart from, its contribution to human development, even for growth, you lose 2 to 3% of GDP if you neglect malnutrition. And also some of the studies have, shown that if you invest $1 in food security and nutrition security, you will get $20 to $30. So it's a big investment even from the finance minister point of view also, not only for human development. And also there is some improvement in food and nutrition security. Recently the IFPRI's hunger index showed that the rank of South Asia has improved. So it's a good sign, but it's a long way to go to because a lot of food insecure people and malnutrition people are in South Asia, the largest number in the world. But our topic is here regional cooperation. How do you improve the regional cooperation is important. And then we have, last year we had on the same topic a conference on that, on regional cooperation, food security. Some of the issues are, of course, cooperation in all the aspects of food security, availability, access, nutrition, stability. One is, regional cooperation in food and agriculture is one, and next the climate change and disaster management in the another one, and of course the trade agreements, we have the SAFTA and other, and also intellectual property rights in agriculture is another area, and also we must have discussed already the energy and water is another issue where, food security is important, and also on global scale, the WTO and other where we can cooperation, and lastly the cooperation in knowledge networks we can have in South Asia where we can have cooperation. So we have an important panel. We have a special address from by Dr. P.K. Joshi, so they will take 10 minutes. And also Dr. Pandey, 10 minutes. And the other panelists, 7 minutes each. Then because we'll have some time for discussion. I'm strict about time, so please maintain the timings. So if you don't stop physically, I may come and stop you. Yeah. So we'll start with Dr. B.K. Joshi. He's the South Asia, the director at International Food Policy Research Institute.
Good morning. At the outset, thanks to the organizers, especially Dr. Nagesh Kumar and Sachin for involving me in this very important initiative. I have been asked to make a brief presentation on this food security and regional cooperation in South Asia. I'll just flag the issues because they are only 10 minutes. I have prepared for half an hour, but I have to squeeze, and chairman is very strict. So, and he's also my boss. He's a board member of IFPRI. So I have to. So I will be talking three broad areas. One is the key challenges in South Asia region. What are the key issues? You are debating yesterday and today morning you are debating on what are the key challenges. I will add maybe few or repeat those. Second is opportunities. What are the opportunities in the regional? And what may be the future opportunities? What are the areas for regional cooperation? Well, the one is the country level issues and other are the regional. And I am talking of the regional cooperation where we can do in a regional perspective. So first is the key challenges in South Asia, South Asian agriculture. And you all will agree with me, the poverty is the major issue in the region. The world's largest population is living here who are poor, and majority of them are living in rural areas and dependent on agriculture. Unfortunately, dependency on agriculture is not declining in the region, though the share of agriculture in the value of economic growth is declining over the years. But dependency is not declining. There are huge yield gaps, low productivity. So one issue is the poverty, and South Asia is hub of poverty at a global level. And if we go further down, India has the one-third in the South Asia region are poor people. And within India, there are a few pockets like Eastern India where most poor people are living. So this one issue is the poverty, poor people. So this is one area where we have to address. The second is undernourishment. As Chairman already mentioned that undernourishment is again an issue in the region. As a country as a whole, different in the region, they are food self-sufficient. But if you go down to nutritional security, they are malnourished. There is undernourishment, child under malnourishment, stunting, underweight, and anemia. You know, the anemic children, you can see that how is big problem this is. And also, we have observed that the food is not a big problem in the rural areas. But undernourishment, malnourishment is becoming a major issue. For example, diarrhea, the sanitation. Diarrhea is becoming a major problem, and due to that, the absorption of nutrition is becoming a major problem. So we need to address, if you have to address nutrition, there are a few pathways. One is agriculture and second is the sanitation, hygiene. So these are the areas we need to address. So this is second issue, a challenge for all of us. Recently, IFPRI released on 16th of October, the Global Hunger Index was released. And you can see from the map, though the South Asia is improving with respect to the malnutrition, but still we have a long way to go. The South Asia earlier it was in a situation of alarming situation, but now it has come too serious. But still you can see that many of the African countries are better off than South Asian countries. This is the status of South Asia as compared to other region. The South Asia has improved. South Asia has improved over the years, but still they are below from other regions. The hunger index is now 18, as compared to if you see African countries where it is 12 in all the developing countries. In Africa and South Sub-Sahara region, it is 18.2%. So the hunger index is coming down, but still it is high. Other problems are environment related issues and human development related issues. So from environment point of view, I'll give highest priority to the climate change. It's a big problem which is emerging. The droughts, the floods, the several rise in temperature, fall in temperature, they are all affecting agricultural productivity or agriculture. And in that way, they are also affecting the poverty and undernourishment. If you see the indices which have been developed, the Global Environment Index or Environment Performance Index or Human Development Index, the South Asian countries are way below. Sri Lanka is doing little better, but other South Asian countries are not doing well. So this is another issue that we have to address, climate change. The per capita incomes are low. If you compare with the East Asia and Pacific region, we are far behind the East Asian Pacific region. Our per capita incomes are very, very low. Agricultural performance, the economies are doing very well in the region. But the agriculture, although it is doing better, but the growth rate in agriculture is far away from the economic growth. So much of the economic growth is coming from other sectors. But though growth is coming from those sectors, but the labor force is not shifting from agriculture to non-agriculture sector. Therefore, it is affecting our performance with respect to the poverty. Issue is that we have large number of small and marginal farmers. The tiny size of land holdings, you can see that Bangladesh, India, Nepal, we have large number of small holders. Many times we say, have our agriculture become crowded? Earlier we used to say small is beautiful. So still small is beautiful with this kind of situation we need to see. Institutions in the region are very weak. Markets are very weak. We have, all morning we were discussing, the supply chains are long. Transaction costs are very high. There are huge post-harvest losses. We did few studies and we observed that the transaction cost, especially for vegetables, were around 15%, milk, these were 20%. So high transaction costs, in view of the small holders, they cannot access market and then they add high transaction costs. Post-harvest losses are very high. So you may need a different kind of infrastructure. Processing is very low in the region, less than 15% in milk, around 1% in milk. So these areas need more processing and generate employment opportunities. Access to credit, which is very important. And in view of the small holders, marginal farmers, the transaction cost of the financing institutions increases. So they do not have an incentive to lend credit to small and marginal farmers. So institutions, the small farmers, marginal farmers, cannot access the credit and other like insurance. Food safety and quality, another issue which is affecting our trade. Policy challenges. Yeah, lots of policy challenges. One is the policy paralysis and uncertainty. Most of the countries in the region were having political uncertainty. Now there is a phase of stabilization. For example, Nepal, it is now stabilizing. India is now stabilizing. Bangladesh is stabilizing. Pakistan, still there are a few problems. So political uncertainty because of these strong decisions, reform process cannot move forward. Many policies are, they add costs because of appeasing policy, like subsidies. Huge subsidies are going in agriculture and other, especially on energy also. Policy gaps are there because of weak governance. Any policy we frame at the top is not being implemented at the bottom. So there are policy gaps between policy making process and policy implementation. The capacity of those who implement policies. Policy formulators may be very intellectual, they have the good ideas, creative ideas, they evolve the policies. But those who implement those policies, they do not have capacity to implement in that way. So there's a gap and the implementation become very, very poor. Powerful bureaucracies, controls, lots of controls, regulations, delays, and that affects the process of attracting private sector in an era of globalization. So these were the few challenges we need to address. And what are the opportunities in agriculture sector? One is that demand for agricultural commodities is going to increase. And more so, it is increasing for high-value commodities, fruits, vegetables, meat, milk, eggs, and fish. You can see the red ones. See, by 20, between 20 and 2025, how the demand for different commodities is increasing per capita. Per capita demand for cereals, rice, wheat, food grains is declining, but of these high-value commodities is increasing. So this shows that there is a huge, huge demand coming in this particular region. So there is a huge opportunity in agriculture. If we invest in agriculture, if we have appropriate policies in agriculture sector, we can take large number of people out of poverty. Production of high-value commodities is increasing, but it is not keeping pace with the demand. So we have high inflation of these commodities. The losses are there. Whatever we are producing, there are huge post-harvest losses. Then another important issue is coming, which is rise of modern markets. There are several models are emerging which are connecting farmers, and I think morning we were discussing this, connecting farmers and improving market efficiency. So these innovations are coming up in the marketing agri-marketing system that we need to look the best practices. And what are the future priorities? We can, there are three broad areas: technologies, policies and institution. And in terms of food security, we need to focus on land related issues, water related issues. Gene is the technology, whether it is hybrid varieties, hybrids, varieties, or I will not go to controversial issue, and the gene and the energy, mechanization, the diesel which is being used in agriculture. So these are the areas we need to focus. This is an illustration for India, how we achieved the food security, production, availability, access and affordability. Over the years, there were different ways the policies were framed and implemented for, can we further strengthen this matrix for improving food and nutritional security. Now, regional cooperation, already three broad areas have been initiated, and we are yet to be implement effectively these initiatives. One is the SAARC Food Bank. Very good initiative, but how to effectively implement SAARC Food Bank? There is commitment from all the countries. Then SAARC Seed Bank, to exchange the genetic material, especially the seed, and the SAFTA, which is not very, very, very effective. So how we can, what are the commodities we can include in SAFTA? Then five areas I have listed for regional cooperation. One is based on what I presented, is exchange knowledge and technologies. This is one area where all these South Asian countries can work together and leverage agriculture, the power of agriculture for food and nutritional security. And these should be pro-poor technologies for sustainable agriculture productivity growth. Then we need to promote regional trade. The regional trade is not taking place within the region. We are doing a lot of trade outside region, but not within the region. But there are opportunities within the region. How we can promote regional trade where we have strength? Then best practices for ensuring food security. There are good social safety net programs around the in this region and outside region. How we can learn those best practices and can ensure food security. Climate change is becoming a very major issue. How we can tackle climate change, adaptation and mitigation together. And we need to see climate smart policies. How we can converse various policies and programs from the lenses of climate smart policies. Then capacity development. Capacity development at different levels, where we have strength in the region, in different countries they have their own strength. So how we can improve capacity of each other through our mutual learning. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Joshi, for a comprehensive presentation. Now we move to the lead presentation, Dr. Poshtaj Pandey. 10 minutes.
Thank you, Chair. Now, I think now you have to count from this point, yeah. 10 minutes. So, good morning, everybody. Well, I'm listening to the Chair and Dr. Joshi. I think, I mean, we have convergence of views. And I think, I mean, there might be some repetition in my presentation also. Well, first I will start with the initiative, SHARC initiative on issues of food security. Then I'll discuss the state of food food security or insecurity and the challenges. Then I'll touch upon national policies of the SHARC member countries to ensure food security. And finally, I would attempt to recommend the areas for regional cooperation in food security. And I think, I mean, I'm going to repeat some of the areas already mentioned by the Chair and Dr. P.K. Joshi. Well, with regard to the SHARC initiative, the issue of food security and nutrition is not new in SHARC agenda. SHARC member states, they signed agreement establishing South Asia Food Security Reserve in 1987 during third SHARC summit, and it was operationalized in August 1988. And in 1997, an initiative on nutrition was initiated. In 2007, SHARC member countries signed agreement establishing SHARC Food Bank. And in 2008, Colombo Statement on Food Security was adopted, and in the same year, SHARC Declaration on Food Security was also adopted. And I mean, these two documents affirmed to ensure region-wide food security. And in 2011, agreement establishing seed bank, and also that was signed, and there was agreement on framework for material transfer agreement in 2011. But however, out of total 842 million people estimated to be undernourished, about 295 million people, that is 35% of the global undernourished people, are in South Asia. Well, with regard to the state of food security, insecurity in Asia, well, it is very difficult to get a single composite index which captures all dimensions of food security as defined by FAO. That is, availability, access, utilizations, stability or vulnerability. But as Dr. Joshi has already indicated, IFRI's global hunger index, it captures some of the dimension of food security. And out of this hunger, is global hunger index, it shows that the situation of hunger has improved, particularly in all three dimensions: proportion of undernourished population, prevalence of underweight children, and under 5 mortality rate. And for South Asian countries, the situation of hunger have moved from the state of alarming in 2000 to the state of serious in 2013, bearing India. And the second factor is the hunger index are driven primarily by the large prevalence of underweight children and the widespread undernourishment of the population. Well, let's try to look at the individual dimension of the food security in South Asia. On the issues of education or availability, most of the South Asian countries, the growth of agriculture is higher than the growth of population. It means there is adequate supply of dietary requirement in all the countries, and most of the requirement are derived from cereal, but there is some change in diet compositions from cereal to non-cereal, particularly from to animal fat. And if we combine the informations of food insecurity and the education of the education availability. It indicates that food is adequate, but there are but hunger index is high and people undernourished people is high. So it means the issue of food security or issue of undernourishment is issue of distribution, as well as indicated by Dr. Joshi, as well as issue of state of nutrition. With regard to access, I mean, with low and middle level income and skewed income distribution, economic access is truncated for most of the South Asian countries. And this economic access is further aggravated by high price of food relative to the price of generic consumption basket. I mean, in all the countries, it's the price of food is more than 50% higher than the price of generic basket. And physical distribution of food has become problematic due to low density of road, except in India and Sri Lanka. On utilization, low sanitation facilities in South Asia indicates low transformation rate for an individual of the food intake into energy and required nutrients. And the access to food is highly vulnerable to imports for most of the countries except India. And more than half of the arable land is rent-fed, except for Bangladesh and Pakistan. And in addition to that, per capita food production, food supply and food price is highly volatile in South Asia. Well, I mean, what are the major challenges for South Asian countries to ensure food security? The first one is inadequate policy, weak institutions, and poor regulatory framework. And here, the problem is announced policy are not backed up by regulatory framework, functional institutions, and adequate financial resources. And another problem, another challenge is increasing populations. I mean, right now the population of South Asia is 1.69 billion, and it is projected to increase to 2 billion in 2030 and 2.2 billion in 2050. And because of increased population, this demand for food will increase. And because of increased population, the pressure on the resources will be high. And in addition to increased population, the rate of, I mean, urbanization, it is also going to be a challenge. And by 2050, more than 51% of South Asian will reside in urban center. And it has two implications. I mean, urban cities will take away the farmland, one point. And second point, there will be change in the consumption, I mean, behavior, particularly of the new rich, or, I mean, middle class, to animal fat.
You have 3 minutes.
2 minutes. And another challenge is pervasive poverty, and the second is low investment in agriculture sector, and it has caused low agriculture capital stock and low productivity in agriculture sector. Another is weak and appropriate technology. Particularly, we have low technology adaptation in farming sector, and it is because the technology, either the technology doesn't reach to the farmers, or the technology is not affordable to the farmer, or it hasn't proven profitable to the farmer, or it is not appropriate to the farming system. And there is another issue is the poor harvest losses. I mean, Dr. Joshi has already indicated. And another challenge is food price volatility. Climate change already discussed. Another is high energy prices and increasing demand for biofuels. I mean, it has implications. I mean, it will compete the farmland, I mean, to produce biofuels. And another, I mean, problem would be cereals would be used to produce, I mean, biofuels. That would be the challenge. And another is poor infrastructure, particularly in the rural areas, and storage facilities. Well, I'm not going to touch upon the domestic policies. Okay, the regional cooperation agenda for regional cooperations. First, we need to, I mean, operationalize food bank and seed bank, and we need to address built-in weakness of these two banks. One is in educator reserve, and it doesn't speak about the role of private sector and national distribution system. The withdrawal condition are not practical, and there is no provision with regard to the price determinations, I mean, out of the use of from food bank. And another is to increase regional trade, which already Dr. Joshi has mentioned. I mean, we need to review sensitive list, particularly with regard to, I mean, food items. We need to dismantle non-tariff barriers, harmonize the standard, and facilitate mutual recognition agreement. And again, I mean, we need to adopt trade facilitation measure for the trade of food items. And because of porous border and because of, I mean, unequal subsidies in food items, we need to coordinate in pricing policies within the South Asian countries. And to protect farmers' rights, I mean, we need to have regional approach to intellectual property rights, particularly with regard to plant varieties protection. And again, we need to improve, I mean, we can collaborate in improving health status. And others are cooperation in weather forecasting, cooperation in natural resources, including water resources, collaboration in agriculture research, and cooperation in adaptation and mitigation of climate change impact on agriculture. Here we need to, I mean, cooperate to address knowledge gap and capacity building. And we can create climate change adaptation fund. We have to promote public-private partnership and South-South collaborative research. And we need to cooperate on the development and transfer of climate-friendly technology. And finally, I would like to conclude with these three, I mean, points. The primary responsibility to ensure food security is that of national government. And regional initiative only complement national efforts. South Asian countries face existing and new challenges for food security. To address this challenge, there are many avenues for regional cooperation. And we should not undermine the role of, I mean, importance of food security. It has political, economic, and diplomatic implication. If not addressed properly, it has the potential to create tension within and between the South Asian countries. With increasing population and full impact of climate change, competition for the scarce resource of food and water has the potential to destabilize the region and undermine many development gains. Thus, collaboration and making resilient and sustainable food system could have major implications, not only for the welfare of millions of people, but also for the stability and peace of the region. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pandey. So now we have four panelists. First, I will request Dr. Abid Suleri. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, and good morning again, ladies and gentlemen. The food security topic, and when I listened to the very valued and very informative presentations of Dr. Joshi and Dr. Poshad Pandey, so I just changed what I wanted to say, and I just have five maps to show. Basically, I take food security as a non-traditional security threat, and I have my own way of explaining why we require regional cooperation in terms of food security. Now, to start with, all other social development problems, I don't believe that we can make an intervention at point A and we should expect a result at point Z. So there is no linear relationship between our interventions and the result that come. Of course, there are 25 other alphabets that needs to be taken care of, and that's where we are talking of food security or food insecurity. Now, I often talk of this 7F crisis. It started with 5F crisis back in 2010, and last 4 years there are three more Fs have added, and all these 7Fs, they are mutually interdependent, and you can't exclude any single and try working on the rest of the six because you won't find the results. So among my 7Fs, we have fiscal problem, we have fuel problem, we have fragility of climate, we have frontiers, we have food problem, we have functional democracy, which means governance, we have fertility. And all these 7Fs, they interact in a way that they are creating individual hunger, they are creating poverty, and they are creating social exclusions. And due to this, one of the results that one see, one of the manifestation, it is social instability. And that social instability, that actually give rises for regional and extra-regional environment in the domestic matters. So this is the broader context in which I wanted to speak. Now, with this 7F, my next thesis is that insecurity always breeds insecurity. So we saw the maps, Global Hunger Index, Human Development Index. I have added Failed State Index, and I have also added World Terrorism Index, and try to see where the brown and red areas are in all those four maps. Of course, it would be too simplistic to make a comparison. The methodologies would be different, the sample size would be different. But if you just look at the trends by these four independent organizations who have produced these maps, so you will find that more or less where hunger prevails, where poverty prevails, those are the countries which have a very low human development index. Those are the countries where we are talking of the state's inability to govern. And those are the countries which flourish on world terrorism index as well. Now, I will also show you the three maps from Pakistan. So this is one of the maps, SDPI and World Food Program. We produce our food security report every 4 years. The latest one would be launched in December, but I am showing you the map of 2009. And according to this map, all the red area, it's only the Punjab, which is dark blue, where we have secure food supply. Light blue is the borderline, and the yellow and red, these are the area which are food insecure or extremely food insecure, and you would find that all the area bordering Afghanistan, all the area bordering Iran, and even the northern part of Pakistan, they are extremely food insecure. This is a physical insecurity map of Pakistan, which was drawn on the basis of number of suicide attacks and terrorist activities, again corresponding to that period. And if you see, it looks like that if one just changed the title of the map. So it was food insecurity map, and then it became the physical insecurity map. And the third map that I have, so this is the district accessibility map. And the third map that I have, it was the analysis of flood 2010. And again, you can see the red and dark red and the light red areas, which were extremely affected by floods in 2010. So the reason I use these maps, these are the 2010 food security map, 2010 physical insecurity map, and 2010 climate change vulnerability map. And to conclude, I would say that in the region, we have four levels of securities. Insecurity always breeds insecurities, and security will always take you to further security. So there are four levels of security. We have global security, we have regional security, national security, and human security. And again, all these four, they are interconnected and mutually non-inclusive. All of the countries in South Asia were working on global security. We try to prove ourselves the most responsible nation among international community. We have our own stakes in regional security. That's why we have a difference of political opinion, as well as our, we try to expand our influence in the region. And we have very predefined notion of national security. But one thing that I feel is being compromised in all the countries is human security, individual security, food insecurity. And my starting thesis was that whenever these individual security, they get any collective identity, be it ethnic, be it national, be it provincial, be it rural, urban. So these individually insecure people, when they get any sort of collective identity, it immediately leads to clash between have and have not. It leads to clash between provinces, it leads to clash between states, it leads to clash between countries, and that's where protectionism and all sort of other things they started coming in. My submission, where I'll conclude, is that perhaps we need to see food security as a non-traditional security threat, and we should give it as much importance as we give to other pillars of security, national, regional, or global. If we want, we'll be ignoring it. I can tell you that Pakistan is a case study. We have a threat within. We don't have any external threat. And that threat within, of course, if you look at this map, it is from the insurgency in Balochistan, it is insurgency in Fatah, it is insurgency in Pakhtunkhwa, so all the border area which are chronically food insecure. So I'm again not trying to be oversimplistic, trying to tell you that all sort of militancy is due to food insecurity or poverty. Of course, there are other reasons as well. But this is again one of the reasons which is quite easy to tackle. We may not change the notion of militants that easily, but one thing that we can do collectively to make this region more food secure, try to eradicate hunger so that some of the individual insecurities that can be removed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Suleri, particularly the relationship between physical insecurity and food insecurity and flood-affected areas. Now I request Dr. Mustafa Rahman. He is the Executive Director, CPD.
Yeah. Good morning. First of all, let me register my deep appreciation of this opportunity to share some of my thoughts on a very important issue for my country, Bangladesh, and also for the region. Let me begin by thanking also Dr. Joshi and Dr. Pandey and Dr. Abid for bringing a number of issues on the board. And let me begin by also reminding ourselves of the seminal work by Professor Amartya Sen, where he showed that by analyzing 200 years of famine, that it in famines in this region, it was never an issue of production, but of distribution and entitlement. So food security, when we talk about food security, I think these three aspects of production, but then access and purchasing power and entitlement are also key issues. So let us not forget those. And I would also like to remind ourselves that the tension and the challenge in this region is that we have diverse interests. We have our offensive interests of countries which are food surplus, like India and Pakistan. We have also defensive interests in countries like Nepal, Bangladesh, net food importing countries. So this tension is something which really makes South Asian cooperation with regard to food security challenging, and I will come to that in a moment. With regard to production, I think one aspect which we should keep in mind is that the data and information on food availability, food production, is something which is not very much in the public domain in South Asia. SAARC Agriculture Council was entrusted with the responsibility of collecting data on an ongoing basis, and we have seen that how countries have not really shared the information with the center, and it has become difficult in terms of really getting at the country level and at the regional level what is the production balance and the demand and supply. Even within countries, if you look at the Ministry of Agriculture and Ministry of Food, you see the tension, because Ministry of Agriculture is it also performance of the government with regard to agriculture. Ministry of Food is concerned with food security, so there is a tension within that also. And I think I would also like to mention that in many of the countries, net food importing countries, import duty on food items are zero tariffed. And our analysis at our center shows that it could become an avenue of illicit financial transactions. Because it is zero tariffed, import of particularly rice has become an avenue to transfer funds from the country as part of illicit tracing through trade mispricing. So these are also new issues which are becoming, making the issue complex. The second issue is with regard to access, and here trade plays an important role. And I think we should recall that in 2000, 7 and 8 when the rice prices became double, within South Asia also we didn't see that the trade that was supposed to take place, and countries were imposing a trade ban. For example, in 2007, if you recall, India had this import minimum export price of $1,000, virtually a ban on export, although India's export within the region of food items is only 1.6%. Pakistan's is about 5.5%. So even within that context, we have seen how countries have reacted. So it's a very sensitive issue, one understands. But when we are talking about regional cooperation, can we also say that, for example, in South Asia, at least with regard to export to the least developed countries, there will not be any trade restriction during times of emergency? Can we come to an agreement on that? But one understands the sensitivity, and that's why, for example, in the context of the WTO, where India is fighting for the food concerns, for example, for the peace clause that India has been given up to 2017, and you know the tension between the trade facilitation and the public stock holding. And I think that South Asia should project a combined and a concerted view in the context of the WTO in terms of supporting India, because if India's concerns are addressed, that also helps South Asia in terms of food security. And you know that the aggregate measure of support, how it is being estimated in the WTO with regard to the food stock holding, and India's position with regard to that, India's concerns with regard to that, the sensitive items within the agriculture, the small farmers' interests, all these issues are very important, and I think that South Asian countries should take should support India in the context of the WTO, because that has a knock-on effect, as I said, with regard to our own region. The third point is with regard to distribution, and we have done some work at our center with South and Southwest SCUPS center, which Nagesh is heading, and we have shown how the public food distribution system can be linked with the SAARC food bank in order to ensure distribution of food in times of crisis. So operationalization of SAARC food bank, which didn't take place when Pakistan was having flood, we couldn't give anything from the SAARC food bank, although supposedly there were food in the SAARC food bank, but it was virtual. When in 2007 there was this crisis with regard to food availability, the SAARC food bank was not operationalized. So how do you operationalize that? And that is the some of the works that we have done with regard to public food distribution system, and how the public food distribution systems in our countries could be linked. Yeah. The other point is that when we talk about food security, we often only think about the interest of the consumers. What is the interest of the farmers? How do you incentivize the farmers, and at the same time, you also ensure food security? In countries like Bangladesh, we had about 600,000 tons of food stock, and after 2007, we are now keeping 1.6 million tons of food stocks. So there is a cost to that, not only just a wastage, but there is a cost to maintaining this high level of food food stocks. So I think from that perspective also, it is important that we have regional more freer trade. But what I was trying to impress upon is that the farmer's interest is also very, very important to keep in mind, and we can only do that by also allowing the farmers to get into the global market. If you have the purchasing power and the global market is free, you can also import if you have the money. But what we are seeing is that we are having to import agricultural inputs at global price, and then the farmers are producing, they are being compelled to sell at the local price, which is depressed because of various policies. So how do you link and give opportunity to the farmers to the global market. That has also become a major issue. And the last point I would like to mention is that many of our countries are now thinking about having commodity exchanges in order to reduce the volatility. But we have seen that some of the countries which had commodity exchanges, like India, during the crisis in 2007-8, they had stopped trading in some of the food items also. So what I would like to mention is that Bangladesh is now thinking about commodity exchange. Nepal has already won. Sri Lanka has already won. So how do we have some sort of a collaboration with the commodity exchanges so that during times of crisis, this does not become a point of speculation, not helping but harming the interests of our country's food security. So that is one caution that I would like to leave with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rehman. Now we have Professor Mukherjee. He wanted 8 minutes, so I hope he'll stick to that.
Thank you. This studies the outcome of a recent report I have submitted to ESCAP Southwest Center. It wouldn't have been here without the support that I got. I'm told that the Earth was born in 7 minutes. I have asked for 1 minute more. So I hope you will kindly agree to that. much has been said. No need to repeat that. Just this one thing, that why agriculture is important for this region. Because food, hunger and all these are very, very multifaceted issues. But in South Asia, it is important because the intra-regional trade in food products is almost twice that of food trade in general within the region. That is one point. Second, as has been mentioned, during the acute food crisis, the trade in food products just dipped much more than the general one. And so countries like Bangladesh were put in a difficult situation, although there was the institutional mechanism, but it was ineffective, as you have already heard. So this is my broadly the plan that I want to work on. And the food scenario in South Asia, you need not go into this table, I will summarize it. Three aspects: that even though production levels in South Asia has become higher than the average of the previous 5 years, yet the forecasts for India, Afghanistan and Nepal for 2014 is below that of 2013. Even good harvests have led to margin decline in prices. Nevertheless, the prices remain high compared to the in 212 compared to the previous year. It varies from 6 to 7%, even 10 to 12%. So this is a matter for concern. What is the methodology that I take? I use USTAB Comtrade data, look at the availability of the flows and work out the period that would be most important to look into. Another aspect is that there have been not enough studies to work on food trade. It generally goes into agriculture. So the attempt has been made to find out what really food trade is. And following the WTO classification, I started this work, and not food categories like tobacco, alcohol, and beverages like tea and coffee were eliminated to bring out the crux of the food products. And all the food products were... The second dimension is they were studied in terms of their... They were classified in terms of their nutritional values. This also is something that I thought was required to understand which are the elements that flow into the nutrient basket in trade flows. So this methodology was accepted. Then look at the food trade balance. This chart gives you the zero is the level where positive values show exports, negative values show imports, and the dark values show within the region, and the blue value shows beyond the region. So both imports and exports, you will see, it's very clear from the chart itself that the regional flows are much, much lower than the global flows. So there is lot of trade taking place beyond the region. That is what has been emphasized. Bangladesh and India offer two contrasts. So I have taken two graphs, one Bangladesh, which is mainly in deficit, and the next one is India, which is a surplus. So the surplus and deficit countries in cereals are in the region. Sri Lanka also has a deficit. The main thing I want to bring out is intra-ASEAN trade in these products is much less compared to trade outside the region. The composition of food trade, that again shows in terms of categories, that most important are fruits and vegetables, followed by cereals, and then sugar and related products. The change over the two periods is shown to be not very much there because the period is short. And so you can easily find out which are the major exporters of these food categories. And as far as imports are concerned, again, these are the important items: cereals, fruits and vegetables, sugar and related. But one thing that I want to underpin is that the pie chart which shows the growth is sugar and related products. And the main suppliers for these products are India and Pakistan. So if they can exchange sugar among themselves, it will be doing a lot good to the trade. Sugar and related products. And as has been mentioned, fats and oils would become important later stage. As incomes increase, these sectors would take off from cereals. The importance of cereals would go down. So fruits and vegetables I'm showing separately to show that their share has improved, particularly sugar and related products. This is sugar and related products. The share has gone up, and both for exports and imports. Now, these are the food categories. There are 11 of them. The analysis is based on these categories. And the methodology used is through the market frontier for these products, which is, I have mentioned, as additional market access frontier. I used to call it potential trade earlier, but due to some suggestions, I take it as a frontier. It doesn't mean that this frontier will be immediately taken up by the supplying country once the, but it tells us that this is the lamppost, this is the market, and this is supply, and this is demand. Now, if the demand is very high and the supply is constrained, one can think of foreign direct investment in that sector to increase the supply, provided the supply is there. The second thing is that there could be a lot of value chain addition in vegetables and fruits, because two-way flow is taking place and there is a lot of scope for that. I don't know why the equation has missed here. You know, it was here, somehow it has not been. So these are the tariff barriers in food products, agriculture and non-agriculture, and this is WTO. And the main thing is that there is a lot of the agricultural sector is more tariffized than the non-agricultural.
2 minutes.
So these are the things that have to be looked into if you want to find the tariff barriers. In fact, this was a very, very complex job, because the region is crisscrossed by so many arrangements that you really don't know which to take advantage of. So you have to look into all these things to find out. And the study tried to find out which would be the best for. So if there is some negotiation on the sensitive lists, it is hoped that this will help to find out where the barriers are. These are the sensitive lists in the potential products. It will help, I hope, the negotiators. There are discrepancies. The second point I want to bring out is that normally the sensitive list is the one that should carry MFN rates. But looking at the notifications, I find many sensitive lists are having preferential rates. That's good as far as the regional, the liberalization goes, but this anomaly will create uncertainty in trade. This discrepancy needs to be removed and be harmonized with the... I don't know whether I could make myself clear, because these are the major recommendations. If I have to end, then I will not read it and leave it at that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Incidentally, a huge database is with me, and if Nagesh allows it,
yeah,
that can be used by others also.
Yeah. Thank you. Lastly, Mr. Matthew Hamill. 7 minutes. Yeah.
Well, thank you, firstly, for RIS for arranging this this year, and I'll try and be very short, since I know we have another presentation, another panel after this, and before lunch. I just want to touch on a couple of key points. I don't think there's anything I can really add to this that hasn't already been said by these speakers here, so I'll try and move quickly. The first thing I want to talk about is hopefully not to preempt the next session too much, but to talk about the Sustainable Development Goals. There's a resolution that's recently been passed in the General Assembly that has a draft framework for the goals that will be negotiated over the next year. The draft second goal is to end hunger, achieve food security, improve nutrition, and promote sustainable agriculture. By 2030, there are a number of goals there: ending hunger, ending malnutrition, and doubling agricultural productivity. By 2020, to maintain genetic diversity through seed and plant banks. I'm sure we'll talk about this in South Asia's perspective in the next session. But the ending hunger goal is there, and I imagine will be a prominent part of the debate for post-2015. There are three areas in which there are described some means of implementation. The resolution and the Open Working Group report have these in detail. But the first is to cooperate in regional and rural infrastructure, R&D, and gene banks for improving agricultural productive capacity, so the sustainability and supply side, the preventing and correcting some of these trade distortions in agricultural markets, which we've heard a lot about, and adopting measures for limiting food price volatility, and whether that means market information, commodity markets and commodity exchanges like we've heard before, and food reserves. So all of these areas, I think, are global goals that are going to be negotiated for global targets over the next 15, 16 years, starting today, I guess. But they're all areas in which regional cooperation is a huge factor in this region for food security. Now, if we have a look at some of the progress, always estimating and projecting what will happen to malnourishment is always a fuzzy business. So this is purely an indicative forecast. But basically, the message here is that we need to move faster than the progress we've made in this region between 1990 and 2014. You can take various methods to estimate this, but even a simple compound growth rate will show you that by 2030, using the current trends, we're not going to get to that goal that we were just talking about. So that, I think, is a key message. You can play with some different figures. There's only extreme scenarios in which past trends on how South Asia's been able to tackle food security and hunger will allow you to reach a goal in which there will be, say, less than 5% or less than 10% of the population malnourished by 2030. And this is true also for some of the newer data, despite, say, India's progress in child malnutrition between the last report of 2005-06 and the recent results this year. So if I just get onto the agenda, I think we have a regional cooperation agenda for food security that I think has been enumerated by each of the speakers here, either partially or in full, and I don't want to go into it too much now, given the time, but there are 10 points on this agenda. This agenda has been developed after consultations last year continuing on to this year in food security, but basically it's to tackle these 10 areas in South Asia: climate resilience and sustainable agriculture, the regional food management in terms of reforming these food banks, seed banks, and even considering other banks and food reserves, liberalization of regional trade, which I think Professor Mukherjee's just talked about, if we want to identify some areas where there's some room to do that, joint R&D, the effective regional knowledge networks, Dr. Joshi explained a lot in his first presentation. In these other areas, logistics on reducing food waste, the Zero Hunger Challenge, which is a global challenge the United Nations has set a target of 0% food waste. We currently have, I mean, if we take Dr. Joshi's estimates, 25 to 30% food waste in the region, that's a huge, huge difference that could make the food security. Increasing the policy coordination, I think we've recently talked about that. Dr. Raman has talked about policy coordination for common positions in multilateral forums and negotiations. Areas in which we can tackle some concrete issues with related to food and agriculture trade in terms of food safety and transboundary animal diseases. Looking at these natural resources management in terms of agriculture and its inputs, basically better management of energy, water, and land that are key factors for assuring that we can meet, the doubling the agricultural productivity, which may become a target post-2015. And issues such as integrated phase classification, which I think is already something that's been implemented in Pakistan, and you may have seen from Dr. Saleri's map. So here are some suggested actions that I've thought could be taken from the agenda that are something that we could consider or put on the table to discuss in SAARC or other regional forums. Basically, the first would be adopting or prioritizing an agenda such as this. Now, there's been previous statements about food security in the past and regional cooperation, but I think it's time now to revisit that and address and prioritize some of these issues and take that on board, own that issue. Investing in connectivity for food security logistics is going to improve your progress for targeting lower food waste. This includes infrastructure, some of the roads, the farm-to-fork idea, and the issues for transport, energy and water resource issues, and then reducing the sensitive lists, again, is something that we could have a look at. Professor Mukherjee's already identified some areas in which perhaps there might be room for negotiation and movement. There are perhaps other areas, maybe establishing a new narrative on baselines to avoid issues where sensitive lists negotiations are used in other diplomatic policy triangulation. So establishing a common framework of how the negotiations are discussed might be important there. Looking at common food security standards and classifications, so while we've seen in some parts of the region an introduction of work with FAO and WFP on issues or integrated phase classification for identifying food security hotspots, maybe we could standardize this in the region, and also standards on food and veterinary diseases. Revitalizing the SAARC Food Bank and operationalizing it, and the Seed Bank as well, and other regional reserve initiatives, such as, say, commodity exchanges, I think might call for a high-level meeting. Now, there's been repeated calls for this ever since SAARC has begun its food bank, and the failure to operationalize it is a large gap in our capacity in this sub-region to tackle food security. So I think a high-level meeting that would call together food and agriculture ministers as well as finance ministers would be probably necessary to actually kickstart that sort of conversation and revitalize the food bank. Strengthening the SAARC Agricultural Center and making that a much larger center for expertise in the region for leadership in food security investments, and not just agricultural extension or information and technology transfer. And finally, adopting either this second SDG or a similar goal for the sub-region would be an important part of looking at how that implementation would, of that progress for ending hunger by 2030 could help. Obviously, you don't want to preempt some of the international negotiations, but in each of these negotiations on the Sustainable Development Goals, the ownership comes down to the national level on how to implement those, and adopting a goal in that sense, either following what comes out of the negotiations for next year or actually taking one now, I think is key here. So I'll end there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have about 5 minutes, so 2-3 questions. Basically, you know, they presented all the challenges of agriculture, food security, agriculture and food security, and agenda for regional cooperation. So, Dr. Soba, yeah, 2-3, yeah, oh, yeah.
I appreciate the research effort in the presentations, but I was somewhat surprised that in any discussion on food security, the papers and conversation took such an aggregate perspective on the subject, because obviously even in Baluchistan and Fatah, no Sardar suffers from food insecurity. So the relevant point is that food insecurity is a specific problem of distribution relating to the lower 40 or 50% of the population, and the specific interventions which are appropriate to that should in fact have been part of the conversation, particularly in India, where in fact you've had both the employment guarantee scheme as an intervention for food security, as also right to food as an aspect of food security. Whether that is a sort of viable option should in fact very much have been part of the discourse. Nor in fact have we really bought into the conversation the whole problems of deprivation of the subsistence and landless farmers, who are also part of the food insecurity syndrome, relating to the inequitable access to markets in terms of the terms they participate, their low share value addition, their low access and poor access to credit, and of course the inequitable access to the main source of food production, which is actually land. So if you want to have any really serious conversation on food insecurity, you better really apply your mind as to who exactly within the populations are facing food insecurity, and to move this conversation away from these aggregates and numbers, which in fact seems to have become a favorable staple in any discussions on food security.
Thank you. Second, yeah. Third, fourth. Please be brief. Yeah.
I'll try to.
Yeah.
Well, I think I would like to compliment the observation and comments made by the panelists. I think much of the areas have covered, but some areas have not been covered, and I want to just flag into the knowledge about food security. The first point is, I think, following Professor Rahman Soban, I think we must understand that agricultural production is not the only solution. And agriculture production is a necessary condition, but it is not a sufficient condition, because the problem of accessibility to food by the poor people, that's not taken into account by total food production. Second point, I think, is related to intersectorality. Now, I think agriculture ministry plays an important part, but agriculture alone cannot do the justice to resolving the problem. And this is because, primarily because, the agriculture ministry has to work with, for example, health ministry, because the nutritional value is increasingly becoming an issue. And safe water, drinking, sanitation and hygiene are becoming increasingly important to deal with nutrition.
I think the organizers are looking at me, so please, because our food security may be delayed. Lunch,
Yeah, the final point, Mr. Chairman, is that the role of women in South Asia and other parts of the world also is critically important. So empowering women can address a lot of issues food security addresses, actually. Thank you.
Yeah, can be brief.
Well, I am always brief all through.
Yeah.
But the compulsions are there. There are many vital points to be stated. One thing is that what I find that most of the speakers, they must have prepared their speeches and papers well in advance. And it is recent current situation has taken place. There is a dip in commodity prices, global commodity prices. How we deal with it, that has not been discussed. How the giver of food security, the farmers, the nodal point, how will he benefit with the depressing global prices? How will he realize his returns? This is one point that has not been discussed. And what type of strategy the South Asian countries should develop in such a situation when there is a depression in prices? One thing is certain, that subsidies need to be given to the farmers and need to continue. There is no doubt about it. Some our friend economists, they raise the issue of taking the fiscal deficit and such things. What I usually say is that if you want to bridge the fiscal deficit, why don't you expand the tax base? In South Asia, there is a vast unorganized sector which goes untaxed. So tax realization from that sector can bridge the fiscal deficit. Yeah. And you need not tax the farmers or need not phase out the food subsidy,
okay,
which is essential.
Yeah.
Another point is...
Now we can discuss over lunch.
Two more points, sir. Yeah. Just two more points.
I have to stop you to now.
Two more points.
Yeah.
Dr. Joshi raised a very good point, yeah, that there is overcrowding over the land and we need to take out people from the agriculture. Where do they go? I think they should have the employment opportunities in the rural areas, the small scale cottage industries related to agriculture,
yeah,
agriculture related industry. And the third final point is,
yeah,
the commodity
please.
Exchange. So we should need to discuss how far it benefits agriculture and food security.
Thank you. The gender. We have to. Last. Yeah, she has been waiting. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Dr. P.K. Joshi, I have a question to you. On your slide on rise of modern markets, I would request you to kindly elucidate what you mean by modern markets. We all know there is a problem of access, but when we talk about reform in markets, we either talk about the use of technology or we are talking about FDI, and then what about the role of intermediaries and how they are different from middlemen? So particularly with reference to market, what suggestions you have to modernize it and also to reform it?
Yeah, the last one. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll just make two quick points with reference to Mr. Matthew Hamill's presentation. In your list of sustainable development goals, I think you missed out on two crucial ones, which have now been recognized recently in the Bonn meeting. The first, of course, is the issue of equity. Equity, the idea of equity is inherent to the very concept of sustainable development, as originally defined by Mrs. Brundtland, which was that sustainable development is that development which enables the present generation to fulfill its needs without undermining the ability of future generations to fulfill their needs. So now if you are worried about the needs of the future generations, you certainly need to be worried or have some sense of responsibility towards the deprived sections within the present generation. So in a sense, equity is built into the concept of sustainable development, but needs to be explicitly recognized. The second is the issue of strengthening institutions. The recent work by Acemoglu and Robinson, and before that by Douglas North and others, shows that the ability to meet any targets is critically dependent on building institutions which can get you there. And I think that perhaps needs to be included in the list. Thank you.
Thank you. If anybody wants to reply, you can reply, but you don't have to. Yeah. Very quick, 1 minute. Yeah.
Very quickly on the last point, yeah, I just focused on SDG 2, the proposed SDG 2. There are actually 17 goals and 169 targets, and equality is definitely one of them, and the institutions are definitely recognized. Thank you.
Yes, a very valid point. Obviously, I was trying to be brief. But of course, then there are various levels of food security. It's not only at a macro level, micro level, but even at household level. And I can say that if you check some of the food secure household, you will find that the women, they are often food insecure because they may have, by culture, keep on waiting that unless and until all the male family members and all the guests and all the children, they are eaten, only then they will take their meal. But for this discussion, because the reference point was region, the South Asia, so I just took a macro picture. And obviously in most food insecure districts and as well as in most food secure districts, you will always find variations and extreme outliers.
Thank you. Professor Sohan obviously made a number of important issues, particularly with regard to food insecurity and the distribution aspects. I mentioned only about the public food distribution system, but obviously there are many fundamental issues like land reforms, market participation of the food insecure, intermediaries that play. You can get many of the answers in his own book, The Challenging the Injustice of Poverty in South Asia. So, sir has the question, he also has the answer. With regard to the issue that was raised by the food price volatility, I wanted to address that by mentioning about the commodity exchanges that some of the countries have already put in place in order to address the issue of volatility. And Bangladesh is also contemplating establishing commodity exchanges, but I was just mentioning about the caution, because when we saw that in 2007, when the food, those exchanges were supposed to perform the task of reducing the volatility, in fact, countries had really stopped trading some of the food items in the commodity exchanges. So that is the challenge. Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Joshi.
I think many issues came up, those are country-related issues. There are many issues which are country-specific. Accessibility is a country-specific issue. I think this session was a regional perspective. So how we can tackle issues at a regional level. So we were discussing, I think what two, three issues may be also flagged. One is that can we do together this maybe SAARC action plan for sustainable and climate resilient agriculture? Can we do it together? And we'll make it together. And then we were promoting SAARC milk grid. In this region, we have a lot of trade on milk, but the milk is not included in the SAFTA. So we are pushing SAARC milk grid, which was initiated by Nepal. But unfortunately, I don't know what is the status. When I was representing India in SAARC, that time we were pushing it, but unfortunately, and it will generate a lot of employment opportunities. And on modern market, my concern is that we should modernize market. Whole value chain is to be modernized. I'm not talking of FDI or non-FDI, but the whole value chain should have to be, and more private sector to be attracted for agribusiness, improving the market efficiencies. Thank you.
Okay. So I thank all the presenters, presentations and the panelists for a very interesting session. Thank you very much.